Welcome to Wowism. I am Coach Clarity, coaching you to expand your perspective to the big picture. Wow, what is Wowism? Well, what happens is when you ask the Holy Spirit for clarification, you get such amazing clarification. You can't help but just feel like just wow, the whole landscape has changed. For instance, yesterday, realizing that Jesus' mission was to show us that both marketing death and marketing life really are the same mistake. And neither one is the answer. They're both the same mistake. Put them down together. This just completely changed the landscape of everything. And so I'm just like, wow. You know, when you look at it, let's imagine a landscape suddenly changed in front of you and everything was different. History was different. The future was different. Expectations are different. Everything was different. Wouldn't you just like just sort of sit there and just go, wow, I'm not going to move. I don't know what to do. This is amazing. This is what happens with the Holy Spirit. When you ask the Holy Spirit for help, you are put on a path of wow. Every day the progress is amazing. The shifting, changing perspectives are amazing. So I call it wowism. I'm a wowist. I practice the wow, full stop and the wow. And it continues. The last several days have just been so maxed out on wow, I can't hardly explain it. The tribulation period, the various dates now are looking pretty strong. Everything is just sort of coming into place and like, oh wow, this is what's happening, wow. The Pope statements. I'm only going to probably live another 2 or 3 years. I'm probably going to resign. Short after several years, et cetera, et cetera. All these little things the Pope is dropping. Why? You see, why? On and on and on and on and on it goes, where the landscape is starting to put it together, and you realize that. What we need is to understand what duality is about, and so we can take a step into what I call supernature, and where it solves duality for us. It resolves this continuity fear between duality and singularity. Reality is a singular situation of isness, where we're perfectly free. Each moment we're free to choose a different experiencing, and we're also free to choose the same experiencing. There's no force forcing us to, no forced change and no forced unchange or non-change, no forced non-change, neither one. It's a singular isness of absolute freedom. And we have been mocking reality really with this a marketing campaign of trying to sell death to God, and also in other realms trying to sell life to God. Both are the same mistake. Now, as far as this world and tribulation time and all the stuff that's happening, I want to give a little clarification about that. There is in this world what we call officialdom, officials, politicians, bureaucrats, officials. Now, their job, as they see it, and most people see it, is to keep population stable, orderly, avoid panic, avoid chaos, avoid anarchy, etc. They want things to be seen as normal. Things are normal. Everything's normal. This is the way things are is normal. This is what's going on. Nothing to see here. Everything is normal. Don't worry. We're in charge. Everything's fine. They want everything to run smoothly. Okay, officialdom. What does officialdom want to do? They want to stay in power. And the way they stay in power is to get you to believe that the way things are, that nothing is abnormal with the way things are. Everything is normal. Everything's going along normally. There's no reason to change power structure or officialdom, right? Because everything's going along fine. It's all normal. There's nothing dangerous or abnormal that we need to be aware of. It's all, no reason for panic, nothing to see here. You know, they want to keep it going that way. That's officialdom. And then there's also the aspect of this world called corporate mentality. Corporations want everything to run smoothly too. They want to be able to assess and predict and properly project the functioning of their corporation into the future. And in order to do that, they function on the basis of needs. They want to control, make sure to standardize and control the needs of consumers, of their products. So what they want is everyone to believe that the needs that they're feeling are normal needs. That this is the way you are. This is how you are. And the idea of changing it is ridiculous. No, this is how you were born. This is how you're going to be your whole life. This is what you are. And so they want to be able to get a stable consumer base so they can make all the necessary business projections into the future of expansion, raw material, manufacturing, distribution, have profit, everything. They want it stable. So, but their driving goal is greed. Whereas officialdom is power. They want to stay in power. Corporations want to make as much money as possible. That's why they want stable markets. So the two in common, officialdom and corporations, have something in common. Stability, needs, normality. Everything is just, this is the way it is. This is whatever's going. No, don't worry about anything. There aren't any troubles coming. Don't panic. Don't get worried. Don't get erratic in your behavior and your needs. Don't change. Just believe in what we tell you are your needs, and everything's normal. So they want to keep this feeling of just stable normalcy going. Now, third major aspect of this world is religions. Religions tell you, don't believe officialdom and corporations. Don't believe that you have within you what will tell you what your true needs are. You see, and officialdom and corporations don't like religion at all. They can help it to the extent that it stabilizes people. They say okay, but they don't trust it because they religion says within you a conversion is possible. Transformation in your life is possible. A change in need, a way you view yourself is possible. In fact, not even possible. This is what you're supposed to do. And a different need structure is supposed to arise within you. And this is something that corporations and politicians and officialdom don't like at all. This is what they're opposed to, actually. Very much opposed to. So, now, ask yourself a question. Are institutions that are run by greed and power, desire for power, desire for greed, desire for profits, and this is their guiding star ideology, okay? Are they, if there's something that is, something is wrong, and looking at that, you're going to say, whoa, we're not safe at all, really. Officialdom isn't doing a good job at all protecting us. This upheaval is coming. This is what's bothering me. I have different needs. I feel I need to respond to this. I have different now, change a pattern of my needs. Do you think if there's something like that, something coming that would disturb the order, disturb one's needs, bring about a turn to religion, we say, I need to find a true center of what I am in order to deal with this upcoming trouble, which would, does anyone believe that officialdom and corporations are the place to go to get accurate information about any such troubles that may be lurking or at work? Is that the place to go? Actually, we would say, no, that's the last place to go. The last place to go for truth about what's going on in the world would be officialdom and corporations. And it probably, if there was some event to take place in the world, let's say just a terrible event, catastrophe, they would not tell you, even up to the last second, they probably wouldn't tell you. Why? Because they'd say, I still can make some money, and I want to try to make as much money as possible. I don't want to tell anyone because it helps me make, I can keep selling my products. And officials would say, no, I want to stay in power as long as possible. To the last second, they won't tell you. So, and they also do everything they can to control information, which is the media, entertainment, education, and all of that. They go together. Officialdom and corporations have an agreement, and they try to bring religion into it. And they have this agreement that they'll cooperate on the news, keep the news just saying, you know, don't worry, minor stuff, this and that, it's all the same, everything's going on the same, human history is smooth, it's untroubled, just a nice little fairy tale, and don't worry, nothing's wrong, nothing bad's going to happen, all these conspiracy people are crazy, absolutely nuts. We tell you the truth, don't worry. If you want truth, come to us, our scientists, our reporters, our media, all this. They'll tell you the truth. That's the last place you want to go for truth. But in order to get to the truth, you have to be an outsider of official and corporations, and to some extent religion too, to the extent that the lust for power and greed gets into religion as it has at times, and there's failings there too. So you have to go beyond all of that and start investigating on your own to find out, you know, what is the truth really about this world. Most people live in like a dream world, thinking, you know, the way they're looking at it. And again, they won't be informed at all what's going on by mainstream media, officialdom and corporations, and to some extent religion. They'll never tell them until it's too late. So what we have is what's called investigators. I'm an investigator, many investigators who said, yeah, I want to find out what's going on. I know I'm not going to get the answers there. I'm going to dig for myself. I'll do my own work. You know, I'm not going to be lazy and sit around and wait for the officialdom and corporations to spoon feed me information via the mainstream media and just, oh, how easy it is. Yeah, this, okay, now I know. I know what's going on. that's the worst, you know, worst way to go about it. But it's tough being an investigator. You know, most people don't believe you. Officialdom is convinced, you know, officialdom and corporations, and to some extent religion, has convinced most everybody that their version of stuff is accurate and is what we want. We all want this stable, you know, normal society where everything runs in a predictable, familiar way. And it's we're told it's good for everybody. But is that really what's going on in the world? So investigators, independent investigators, maverick investigators, have been, you know, digging. A lot of people do this. And they've come up with a lot of information. And everything may not be so normal and safe and wonderful. And our needs that we have may not be our real needs at all, as a matter of fact. I have said that this world is actually only just a marketing campaign, marketing death. And we all feel here that this is what we need to do. We need to market death to God, actually, and get God eventually to buy it from us, so then we won't have it anymore. It's like saying, yeah, death is real, but we can get free of it because God will buy it from us and take it off our shoulders, the burden away from us, save us. So the view of salvation would be then that, yeah, death is real, but God saves us from it by purchasing it, you know. Where, from God's standpoint, death is not real at all. There is no such product as death. It's an imaginary, non-existent product. Totally. So God can't save us from death. There isn't any death. So we think that normality is just to keep on with this marketing campaign, trying to sell death to God. But this marketing campaign has a lot of twists and turns to it. And these are the things that officialdom and bureaucracy, corporations, and into religion to some extent won't really tell you, although some religions do point out that prepare for catastrophe, prepare for difficulties. This is what we've been warned about. And of course, corporations and officials, them hate that. They don't want you thinking along those lines because you're unpredictable then to them. You see, they can't count on your vote, and the corporations can't count on your purchasing. You know, they don't know what, you see, to them, you're dangerous, you know, you're against the state, so to speak. So what is happening is that you have to rely on your own intuition, your own investigation, you could read others' investigations and try to find out. You can, religious people read holy books that purport to tell them, although their interpretations of it vary widely. So I have said the next 18 months leading up through June of 2016, through June of 2016, are very important, very, very important. This is when what's called a blitzkrieg of the advertising campaign, the marketing campaign of marketing death. Will there be very strong push to collapse the will of everyone into compliance with what I call the cosmic corporate culture, the CCC, which is taking over this planet, which is incorporating this planet. And this will get us ready when it comes to July of 2016. The world will probably be in compliance with some global takeover. And some say it's the Antichrist will be in power at that time. We'll have authority. We'll have this great authority over the world at that time. And people will accept it. They'll be in compliance with this. So somehow we have to avoid this blitzkrieg of advertising, marketing, pressure to get in compliance with what cosmic corporate culture wants for this planet, which is a centralized bureaucracy. Global bureaucracy, global globalization of everything. Centralized religion, one currency, try to standardize everything as much as possible on a global scale. They see that as this is in alignment with what their views are. What we want is we want to avoid this supersaturation marketing advertising campaign in the next 18 months to pull us into compliance. So this is my viewpoint in my investigation, a lifelong investigation of many, 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 many areas. Whatever it is, the Holy Spirit says, look at this, look at this, look at this. I look at it, just say, wow, this is, we're not being told by this, by the mainstream media or officialdom or corporations or even religion. This is very amazing. Why is this not being talked about? And then you look for other information. So we continue digging in, sharing information here, just to help everyone in their investigation. Everyone have to come to their own conclusions one way or the other. And what I always say is our problem is a continuity problem, in that the good news is so good we can't quite accept it. I dreamed last night, and somehow I ended up, I was looking for a hotel that I thought I'd been to once before, and I ended up in this other hotel, and I was asking them, do you know where this hotel is? I can't find it. And they said, no, I've never heard of it. And I said, well, it's real close, should be right real close. I said, I don't know this hotel at all. The hotel, that was the concierge or the front desk I was talking to, I was aware that this hotel was amazing, so deluxe. I said, this is too high class for me. I can't stay here. This is too expensive, but just, I don't deserve anything that is this deluxe, that's for sure. But the concierge was very accommodating. He said, he gave me a bottle of wine, poured me some wine. He said, here, you have some wine. It's free. It's on the house. I said, what? Expensive bottle of wine. I don't drink wine, but I said, well, okay, what is this? So I was certainly not being run off in any way, but I felt like this place is too deluxe. I I don't deserve it. I can't afford it, don't deserve it. But it was an deserve it. See, our problem is what we actually are, what we deserve is so wonderful. We just can't believe that we deserve it because we've been marketing death, mocking reality really by through the marketing of death to it for so long and marketing of life to it. We feel we just don't deserve anything really great. So this hotel, looking at it, I was just, said, look at the handiwork. Everything was just, I can't hardly describe it really. It was so deluxe. But then I'm thinking today, I said, hey, you know, maybe that's super nature. That's the next realm. That's the realm we could go to, a sidestep the troubles of this world. It's like going to a hotel, like a vacation. And it was really very close to the hotel I'm used to, which you might say is this world. But they say, no, I don't even know this other hotel. I don't really know this. So it's very close, but somehow protected from this world. And I was thinking, hey, maybe I can't stay there. And I'm trying to think, well, how can I afford this? And then I'm thinking, maybe God pays for the rooms. You know, maybe God pays for the rooms. Or maybe it's God's house and we're like the children who get to live in that house. You know, maybe there isn't a price upon it. Or maybe someone is sponsoring me or sponsoring us. Or maybe, you know, I and others have through our work here, have earned it. It's like you're working in order to earn the house. You do sufficient work in the fields, you get a house for that, housing. You get a room in this deluxe hotel resort. Or it's really cheap, you're not charging us a lot, or it's subsidized, subsidized for us. So there's all sorts of possibilities. I didn't ask in the dream, I just thought like, this place is too good for me. It's way too good for me. I don't know how I can, but I said, let's reassess it. And maybe I'll say, okay, I'll stay here. I'll do my part and I'll stay here. And it's interesting, everything was woven there. All woven together as one, and it sort of symbolized like two different marketing campaigns, marketing campaign of death, marketing campaign of life, together as one there. One marketing campaign, one attempt to market to freedom, absolute freedom. The attempt to market to freedom has these two aspects to it. Marketing force change, marketing force non-change. And both of these seem to be there. Everything was like woven like a matting or something. It was quite extraordinary. So maybe that is like a realm that we can hang out in. Maybe that's Jesus' place. Symbolically or something. And so, you know, I didn't leave, I didn't say no, we were just sort of talking, left it at that, just sort of, I was thinking like, huh, what's going on here? How come they don't know this other hotel, and it's not there? I swear it was like right in this area, it's gotta be real close. I said, what's the name of it? I said, it's something to do with, I think the owner of the Sharks owns this hotel. Well, the Sharks, what are they? You know, basically, they're killing machines, death machines. So this other hotel is probably where you reside when you're marketing death to God, right? So they did not direct me there. They didn't say, oh yeah, it's right over there. They said, no, I'm sorry, I can't help you. I can't really tell you where it is. I don't know where it is. I can't, it's not familiar. I said, they're not familiar. They said, we're not familiar with that place. We're not familiar with that place. Interesting, right? Not familiar with that place, the hotel that the owner of the Sharks, I guess reference to San Jose Sharks. Sharks meaning, of course, yeah, predators, ultimate predators, place of death, predation, marketing campaign, marketing death. So something's going on. about a dwelling place, a dwelling place. This is something that is very important, because the pressure on us going forward now is maybe too extreme, actually. Maybe too extreme. And most people think, oh no, what pressure? It's like the people who say, no, nobody's trying to take your guns, that's ridiculous. Fairy tale, nonsense. Well, they may not be trying to take your guns, but they're sure taking away all the ammunition. You see? And so the people listen to officialdom and corporations, and they say, oh yeah, nobody's taking guns. That's the crazy people. It's crazy. And when you tell them all there's no ammunition, it's like, oh, I can't quite compute that, you know. It's whatever. And still, they're not trying to take your guns. They can't quite put two and two together. And so it's that way all the way down the line, and they remain ignorant. Again, Jesus said, parable of 10 virgins, you know, 5 trimmed their lamps and got oil for their lamps, and 5 didn't get oil for the lamps. They didn't pay attention. And when they needed to act, you know, the right way, they couldn't. They couldn't get in. So we were told, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the end times. Well, in the days of Noah, well, what was going on? It's a question. Were there not extraterrestrial visitations? Was there not genetic, all sorts of genetic aberrations taking place at that time by these ETs? Maybe some mantid, reptoid alliances with this type of genetic engineering, forms of half this, half that, and all this abomination, right? Isn't that what God got, why, quote unquote, the flood came to wipe out what was going on Earth? Because of abominations. Don't we have, again, this massive incorporation of the planet, really by an alliance of cosmic corporate culture, an alliance of various extraterrestrial races, along with the humans. Many humans have allied themselves with this and aligned. And are there not all sorts of genetic experimentations going on in the world right now? Yes, there are. Are not people frantically diverted by singing and dancing and these kind of diversions? Yes, they are. And so you start to see that it is like the times of Noah right now, very much like the times of Noah. And those who are warning people, very few listen, very few listen. The book 2019, The End Times, by David Montaigne, David, M-O-N-T-A-I-G-N-E, and another, he has a new book, just Christ, Antichrist, 2:16 through 2:19. Is doing some very interesting investigation, and yet very few are interested in this. I was looking to see, like Noah, you know, Noah says, hey, this is flood is coming. Nobody paid attention. Again, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the end times. Is very few people can put two and two together. But there are some that do. It's just not many listen. But more importantly than dates is truth about what we are, our identity, and what options this truth can open up for us if we realize we don't have to be engaged with either the marketing campaign of death nor the marketing campaign of life. This is the crucial insight I had. The Holy Spirit gave me yesterday. I believe that was the 5th of January, 2:15. 1-5-2-1-5. 1-5-2-1-5. 1-2-2-1-5, right? 1-2-2-1-5. Interesting. Seeing this, it helps you step out of the whole cycle of existence, actually, into what I call supernature, the real world, into the vision of oneness. It's a transformative, you know, in a shift of perspective, a real wow. and to see that Jesus' mission here was to inform us both ways were our mistake, not just one or the other. Don't call me good. What do you mean good and bad? Forget about that. No. That's not it. See, that's duality. People thought, here's our Savior. He's come to market life, and to these idiots here are marketing death. And then ultimately Jesus showed them that, no, I'm not here to market life either. I'm not marketing death. I'm not marketing life. I'm marketing what he called eternal life, or eternal isness, which is not a product. It's not a market. It's something that's marketed. You can't market what we eternal life, which is absolute freedom of and perfect isness, pure spaciousness. You cannot market it either as life nor as death. So Jesus came to show us that, reveal that to us, and he said it would take a lot of explanation by the Holy Spirit, which it certainly has done. But this is preparing, putting oil on our lamps. The oil is the oil of wisdom, so the lamps don't go out. You see, the lamps, the light remains, whereas those that don't have that, the light goes out under the pressure of this blitzkrieg of advertising campaign to essentially comply with cosmic corporate culture and their spokespeople here. And what some call the Antichrist would be a spokesperson of the cosmic corporate culture here, speaking for them and saying, okay, I know what to do. I know how to solve the problems. I'm going to bring in my team. We're going to get it done on a global scale. So they want crises to happen, which is why you look at stuff and you say, why are they letting this happen? It's crazy. They let it get going into a crisis mode. Now, oil is, we should realize, as I've said over and over and over, these next 18 months are a big time crisis potential. And look at oil, fell another 4% today. Stocks fell again today. This low price of oil, it is a extreme indicator of something's going on in the world. See, now, again, officialdom, corporations, all, you know, say, no, nothing to see here. Just a correction, nothing to see. Really. And the Saudis are still producing like crazy. Why would they do that? Wouldn't they want to cut back production so that the supply would shrink, diminish, so that the price would go back up? So somebody wants the price of oil to go down big time. As I've said, it could very well be an economic war against Russia to bankrupt Russia. Or it could also be bankrupting the United States. All their new companies are exploring oil. This is some, and because they can't compete with that low price, whereas the Saudis can, having reserves to handle. This is a classic thing of driving your competitors out of business. Classic monopolistic practice. Okay, or it could just be there's worldwide recession, no demand for oil. Which is a real bad indicator. So there's three possibilities that, you know, right off the bat, that are all of them very bad possibilities. And the final one would just be, you know, well, it's just a market correction. But global price of oil is something more important than just a simple market correction on some overvalued stocks. You know, see, that is very different. I mean, the Saudis claim that the oil could go as low as $20 a barrel. Well, that would drive a lot of people out of business. That could cause recessions all over the world. This is a very worrisome situation. So you just add that to the mix, and you have a lot of situations now in the world bringing about turmoil, bringing about crisis. As I've said, I saw in a dream problems in Turkey in the Levant, and very strong problems. A tempest is coming. I think, Greek oil tanker was hit yesterday in Libya by extremists. Oil, Greece, debt, stuff. So they want crises to happen. They want crises to happen, which strengthens their position to come on the scene and say, hey, look at stuff. It's out of control. look, everything is wrong. You guys aren't doing it right. I know how to do it right. Give me the control. I'll fix everything here. You know, like that. I have God-given powers to fix everything. This is how demagogues function. They love crises. That's what Mao Zedong in Tibet, the crisis in eastern Tibet, when they collectivized their farms. Mao said, oh, this is great. This is wonderful. Let it get worse. Let it get worse. And then we'll have a perfect excuse to go in and to take the whole place over and just absolutely, you know, annex it. Because it's out of control and everybody's getting all freaked out and frightened and just too dangerous. And we'll be the saviors. We'll be seen as the saviors at that point. And we'll be welcome in larger areas. So we bring normalcy back, control, order, and stable profits and whatever, you know. So first comes the crises. Those who can ride it out, have enough cap, enough reserve, often are the ones fomenting the crises. Like if the Saudis, if they're fomenting this crisis, I don't know for sure, but they have so much reserve, they can ride out, you know, just drop the prices down so low, drives everyone else out of business, and they can survive that. And then once they gain a monopoly, they'll get it all back and more. It's classical monopolistic practice. So this could very well be a time of crises. Just look at how fast oil has dropped and continues to drop. Another 4% in one day. You know, this is headed towards something rapidly heading towards something. This is what I've been warning people about. I said, all this big push you've been doing is so we would be very strong by this time and able to somehow deal with this blitzkrieg, this crisis, the saturation of pressure to collapse everyone into compliance with dualistic beliefs of the cosmic corporate culture, which believes in you know, perfecting this marketing campaign. They say there's a way to perfect it. Don't worry. You don't have to give it up. You don't have to deal with this continuity fear of giving up marketing campaigns. They say, no, we have experts here. We know how to market to God. Don't worry. And that's what everybody wants to hear. I say, oh, good. I was worried I had to give up the marketing campaign and God would never buy death from us. I didn't realize I have to do a lot of work to overcome this continuity fear. And I'm really scared about that. And, oh, here comes on a white, you know, white horse, the savior saying, don't worry, no, we can get God to buy this. You just have to apply these various metrics and parameters and we'll get it all in ship shape and we'll make the right presentation to God. Don't worry, we know how to do it. And then the people say, okay, welcome, saviors. This is great. I'll be in full compliance, whatever you want. Don't worry, whatever you want. And so, this is what's going on. And we are suckers for that. So, this is the problem. Under this pressure, and when things get worse and worse and worse, and people start saying, oh my gosh, we need someone to help us. And this marketing campaign is not working. It's not working. But we're too afraid to set it down. So, what we look for is the power for someone to say, I know how to get this marketing campaign back on track. And in fact, it'll be better than ever. And the people just like, oh, wonderful, here's our savior. This is what we have to look out for. And this is what's likely to happen. And I said, by July, before we hit July of 2016, this is what I've been saying now for quite some time. Before we hit that, people are likely to be conditioned enough and feeling like, wow, we're going off, the train's going off the track here. We don't know what to do, but we need help. And then the world's so-called world savior, some will call it a world savior, others call it the Antichrist, will say, I know the answers, don't worry. Not a problem. It's just these bad people here and here and there. We can clean it up. We'll get it right back on track. But we need to have control in order to do it, of course. Control. The problem is you'll never get back that control. They say it's temporary. Of course it's temporary. Don't worry. We'll give it back to you. We just got to fix everything first. So So, and then that's the incorporation of planet Earth into the CCC. At that point, the people will agree that incorporating the CCC is the way to go, because then it'll be start unfolding as, oh, they're really smart. Oh, wow. Guess what? They're here to help us. Oh, wow. Guess what? There's no problems, nothing to fear. Everything will be great. Oh, wow. Great. And the people will be like that. And it, you know, all this informational stuff will start, you know, and the younger generations have been conditioned. I was in a doctor's office today, and there was this magazine called Highlights for Kids. Highlights, I think is that the name of it, right? And on the picture was this girl, an elementary school girl, and she was doing artwork, and she held out this drawing she had done. It was a picture of Tyrannosaurus Rex with his mouth, like, ready to just, you know, devour someone. And she's going like, wow, look at this. Isn't this cool? Look how cool. Look how great my art is. This is a child's magazine, you know. And so I said, wow, let me go through this magazine. I saw, like, in the magazine, you know, six different depictions of dinosaurs from dangerous reptilians. And a whole article, what's the difference between dinosaurs and lizards? This was, like, highlighted in this magazine for children. What's the difference between dinosaurs and lizards? And so this is just an example of what I've been saying for so long, is the younger generations are being conditioned to accept reptoids as normal. Oh yeah, of course, I'm used to them. Dinosaur, reptilians, sure, no problem. They've been mainstreamed into that. So when all this happens, it'll be easy that people just shrug and say, yeah. And also, more and more people bringing dogs into public places. It's incredible how much this is happening now. And we're being conditioned not to complain about anything in this world right now, right? I was thinking like, hey, you know, the past, I say, hey, why are you bringing a dog in here? Is that allowed? Is that right? I mean, I love dogs, but, you know, bringing it into a supermarket and putting your basket and carrying around your grocery basket into church and all that stuff. It's like, this is getting us ready for having different types of animals around us and everywhere we go, aliens actually, different types of races, where we feel like, oh yeah, we can't complain about this. It's, who do you complain to these days? Nobody complains about anything, it seems like. And so if you feel like raising your voice and complaint, you feel like you'll be all alone. Nobody will have your back. Nobody will have your back. And so if you complain about aliens, nobody will have your back. They'll say, what are you talking about? This is diversity, there's nothing wrong here. And once you get accepted for a certain length of time, then it becomes almost impossible to complain. Because they say, no, we've been doing this for quite some time. Nobody's complained, so you must be out of line. Yeah. I just, they could look to say, so, hey, don't you realize, you know, that, I mean, I don't agree with bringing dogs into supermarkets in your basket and everywhere you go, putting food in your basket. You know, it's just not a good idea, actually. Right? The bathroom habits of dogs, the fleas of dogs, it's just not a hygienic practice that civilized societies have certain limits for animals, and we're seeming to just say, forget all those limits. Animals can go everywhere we go, they can go. Well, similar with aliens, so in the future, very soon, there'll be aliens on this planet, and we will just accept them like, oh yeah, yeah. Well, some say there are many aliens already in places like Berkeley and New York, and certainly, you could say that human aliens, so to speak. Where no matter what anyone does, people just don't even pay any attention. You know, so you could be literally an alien in New York City. You know, like a reptilian with stuff sticking out, your spines coming out of your back, and a tail, and slit eyes, and the scaly, you know, color scaly skin, and all muscular and everything. It's just, you could be, you know, standing on a street corner in New York, nobody would pay you any attention. Just walk right past you. No big deal. Or they might say, hey, this is cool. Hey, really cool. And, you know, so, of course, if they went out in someplace in the country, it might be a different story, right? Which is why they're very nervous about, you know, the outback, really. They don't like the people out there. But in the big cities, nobody pay them any attention. So probably there are already quite a few there being integrated in various ways, various hybrids and stuff in the cities. And the cities are, of course, progressive. Progressive means accepting the presence of aliens on this planet. That's the ultimate definition of what progressivism really is accepting the presence of alien races on this planet. And they're already there. I mean, most progressives will say, well, of course, why not? We're inclusive. You know, and then of course marriages with the aliens, genetic mixing, they probably do it, you know, test it with mixing genetics. That too would be a sign of progressivism. Of course, they say. Of course we accept them. Let's marriage between grays and this and this. Let's everybody just get married. Let's just all mix it all up, like, and throw everything into the pot. This is the new marketing campaign. throw everything into the stew. And so this could come about very quickly, actually. And who's to say, in many of the cities, big cities, I mean, a lot of the humans there are weirder than the aliens, to tell you the truth. I mean, you know, just like human population is very diversified, the alien population is also, races also have some diversity. And, you know, just there's different, all right, so we're not stereotyping alien races necessarily. They do have their attributes, most definitely, which are true for them, characteristics for sure. There are plenty of humans that are way, you know, stranger than a lot of the aliens. That is true. But it may be that exposure to these aliens have caused them to go a little wacko, you know, get really imbalanced. A lot of the humans are very imbalanced now because they could not get past the wow of these alien races, and you know, it's just like it's too much for them. So they lost their center, and they're just imbalanced. So many humans are very imbalanced at this point. And I've always said that you need to just have a sense of humor and realize that what you are is completely above all appearance whatsoever. This is all just a ridiculous marketing campaign. It doesn't matter who's doing the marketing. Well, you get some different salesperson in there, and you're supposed to say, wow, this is it. Now, the car is the same. It's a non-existent car, and so what does it matter? You get some different salesperson in there, you know, different sales, wearing different suit of clothes or something. It doesn't matter at all. It's ridiculous. So you should not be in awe of any of these ET races at all, not at all. And you should not mock them, but you should have good abundant humor at how absolutely ridiculous and silly and completely unnecessary it all is, and it doesn't indicate anything whatsoever. And so it's like a joke, basically. It's like a funny, silly joke, is a way to put it. So you have a good laugh at it, and not scorning it or mocking it. We don't do that. But we look at it as a very silly, ridiculous joke that is oftentimes quite funny because it's so stupid. Like that is like we're trying to, again, the way we try to convince God to buy this non-existent car, you know, product death here, is really funny. All the antics we go through, you know, we go through so many antics. So here comes a whole new set of antics, and just look at it like a whole new set of antics. Don't take any of it seriously. Don't take it seriously. And then you regain your center, you know, of divinity and I am, and you become, you know, you become much more centered, and not so intimidated by all this nonsense, all this silly marketing campaign that we've been engaged in for so long. Here comes some, you know, the salesperson went, wait a minute, I'll be right back. And they come back with, they got a costume on, like a clown costume. They say, okay, now we're gonna, you know, here, I gotta tell you what about this deal. You know, I wasn't gonna tell you this before, but I'm gonna tell it to you now. Because, you know, you hung around for so long, and I really respect that. And I didn't really wanna sell the car to you at all, actually. But you've impressed me so much. You're talking to God. God, you've impressed me so much. You've hung in there, you haven't gotten angry at me or anything. And I'm so impressed with you, God. I actually finally decided I am going to sell it to you. And look at it from God's perspective. It's quite funny. It's quite funny. And this is how we need to look at the whole situation from God's perspective, which is really our perspective too, being spirit, extension of God. And it's quite funny how we're trying to sell ourselves reality on non-existent product. Product that can never exist. In fact, no product can ever exist. We're trying to sell ourselves on product, whether it's life or death, you know. So it's good to go over these things. They're jests, you know, they're really just jests, but the world forgets to laugh and takes it all so seriously, you know. So okay, CCC is so serious, you know. got to implement these changes, get everyone in compliance. We have all these plans and everything. This is how we're going to market it to God. You know, this is how we're going to succeed. We've got the blueprint. We've got the blueprint here. So this time is a time of humor, of seeing the jest and laughing along with the jest. It is really quite funny. This is how to diffuse, deflect the pressure of these times. If you don't do that, you're going to take it too seriously, because the situation will seem to be coming so serious. The tempest will be so serious. This oil thing is not a joke. I know people who have definitely gotten their money out of stocks at this point. The right time, probably. It is a highly volatile scenario going on in the world right now. Potentially, right? Obviously. The potential is there for great volatility. So, maintaining this humor, I'm bringing this up more and more, focusing on. I did this one video. God, what a deal I have for you. If you haven't viewed that video yet, check it out. It's my favorite video, because the whole thing is this, is laughing at the jests that we make, this funny ways that we try to be real clever and figure out, how can we sell this to you, God? You know, and try practicing that. You know, it's very good spiritual practice. Maybe the best that I've ever come upon is how are we trying to sell God on non-existent product? And then remember to laugh at it. It's really funny. All the strategies we use. Oh, boy. And more pop up into my mind every day. You know, it's just, hey, so that's a good one. You know, that's a really good one. That's a very clever one. That's a very ingenious one. All sorts of guilt and stuff. God, I wasn't allowed to sell this to you yet. Oh, see, I wasn't allowed to. I hadn't evolved enough to be able to even do this. But now I have. I've evolved enough. The photon belt has, you know, evolved me to the point where I'm now finally able to sell this to you or give this to you. It's changed the gift. The gift has been fundamentally made appropriate, consecrated. These are some that I've mentioned before, but there are new ones that come up. I realize, wow, we're very inventive. Very, very inventive. Yeah, we just didn't have the proper brain power working on it, but now we did. Now we have, and now we got it for you. Anyway, it's all a jest. It's all a silly jest, the entire situation here. It is nothing more than that, actually. It's a total silly jest. And Jesus points this out very clearly. He says, you know, your entire problem, really, if you want to boil it down, is you forgot to laugh at this silliness. You just forgot to laugh. You took it seriously. He said, then how do you ultimately solve it? Just laugh at it. You just laugh at it. That's it. And you're done. He says, that's actually, boil it all down. It boils all down to that. So we're remembering to laugh at it here, which is the ultimate teaching, actually. It really is. It's the ultimate teaching. Is, can you directly just laugh at it and see the jest that it is? I'm not saying just laughter per se is the answer. I'm saying seeing the jest, the way we're trying to sell it to God, and then laughing at that and seeing that, well, this is all just a jest, it's all just ridiculous jest. That sort of laughter is what ultimately liberates us from this. We don't take it seriously any longer. As we bring these to light, and there's so many, you can just probably just, you can come up with hundreds and hundreds of different strategies that we use. All of them completely futile. All of them completely futile. And we're always thinking about, you know, what, how can I do it? How can I finally succeed here? We view success like that. We finally get God to take death off our hands here. We're tired of marketing death. We want God to finally say, oh yeah, you got a nice product there. Isn't that amazing? I never seen that before. It's just something I didn't even grape myself. Isn't that great? Okay. okay, I guess I got to take it from you. Or you can say, God, you're not God unless you take this from us. We'll never believe you're God unless you take this from us. You see, but if you want us to believe you're God, then you got to take this from us. Maybe use that one. God, what we have here is just a misunderstanding. That's all. Failure to communicate. And what we have here is a failure of communication, God. And it's just a communication problem is all it is. And we're working on it. So let's work on it together. Together we can solve this communication problem. If that's all it is, God. It's just a misunderstanding. Just a misunderstanding. So, you know, it's something that's very solvable, right? It's very solvable, is what we say. We're just working on this is a misalignment somehow, God. It's just a misalignment, actually. We're just working on realignment, realigning here, getting the right alignment. And we base whole civilizations and cycles and cultures and belief systems and teachings and everything upon these silly jests, you know, the marketing strategies. In the world of advertising goes through all sorts of marketing strategies. They're always changing their marketing strategy. But you can see what their strategy is. You know, it's very obvious that, you know, they keep doing this until it doesn't work so well, then they switch gears and try another marketing strategy. You know, the big one is the man-woman thing that they love to play, this one with God. And the woman now comes along and says, God, I'm so sorry it took me so long to get rid of these stupid men who don't know how to point out the true value of death to you. And I'm so sorry they wasted all your time. It's just horrible. I'm totally with you. I mean, I can understand how angry and upset you are. And I just ask him, please, you know, for forgiveness for these idiots who, you know, couldn't close this deal with you. What a deal we have for you. And hey, they're so stupid, they couldn't even know how to close the deal. But I'm here, and it's like, it's easy with me. We'll easily get it done. Now we finally got the idiots out of the way. And this is the big one that's being used. This is like one of the meta strategies that's being used, is the men are idiots. They couldn't close the deal with God, but now here come the saviors, the women, who they know how to close the deal. This is like one of the overall marketing strategies of the time. The other one is this alliance of cultures, of cosmic races, and corporate culture. Is saying, God, we're really sorry that you know we understand now that we needed to market to you collectively, and we were trying to do it just individually and separately. And so we're going out all together. We're going to market this to you together. Inclusiveness. You see, no divisiveness, no separation between us. We're all one marketing team now, you see. And we know that's what you were looking for. See, that's why we know that's what you're waiting for. And the reason that's why you haven't bought it yet. But now we're doing what you want us to do. So, hallelujah, we know that our salvation is nigh. Again, total silliness. Complete futility. How we market futility is quite funny. You know, God, you say, God, you know, we don't have to market this to you. Actually, we've got a place that's better than reality, actually. And we're just doing this as a favor to you, actually. Because we got a place way better, and this actually, God, will enable you to actually abide where we're abiding now, which is way better than reality. So this is like a huge favor we're doing you. You know, you might not always want to do this favor, you know. So it's like, well, this deal won't always be around. The deal's ending soon. You know, come on in and buy your cars right now. Come on, God, buy death right now. We're doing you a big favor. God, you can't resist. You're unable to resist this. You have to get it. You don't have the capacity to say no. You try that one too. You don't have the capacity to say no to it. And so you have to say yes. You keep saying that. You have to say yes. You don't have the will to say no. Push that on God. Or we say, God, you don't know this yet, but things are really going to change for you real rapidly, actually, God. Reality is actually going to go through a big change. It's written, and so shall it be. And this, what we're offering you, death, actually, it's going to help you. Warning you, and out of our grace, we're giving you this capacity to survive it. Catastrophe is coming across upon reality, and this is the arc that you need to survive it. So here you go. Yeah. So everything that we're acting out here is just a marketing campaign, trying to convince God. See, this stuff happens, God. You see catastrophes happen, God. You see, you need help, God. You need this. You need this. You need. God, we have conducted a long-term marketing survey, and we have found that you actually do have a need for this. You actually do have a need. You just don't know it, but we do know it. So here it is. You know, this is a failure's need. You can't resist. You cannot resist. It's part of your intrinsic nature to accept this. You know, keep trying different ways. God, this is actually preventative for you. You know, you just have it and put it on the shelf, but someday you're going to need it. So you don't have to use it right now. And if you don't see any need for it, it still, you should just have it just in case. Just in case. Put it for a rainy day. Rainy day fund here. Just have death on your cupboard. You'd look a whole lot better with this, I'm telling you. You look great now, but this will give you a whole new look. Whole new look. It's a makeover. You need a makeover, God. It's time for a makeover. You've been this way for so long. You know, you're probably bored. You know, this is an exciting new makeover for you. Death. Exciting new makeover. You can come into a new relationship with creation now. A new relationship, actually. Yeah. It'll be just a, you know, amazing diversity and amazing new experiences, God. Accepting death from us. That's, you can't even imagine what it'll be like. It's infinite. It's endless and glorious, glorious. You know what, God? It's so wonderful that you'd be finally be able to actually come to this world and walk this world with us as a human, as a flesh, body of flesh, if you accept death from us. How about that? Can't beat that, can you? Yeah, you'd actually be able to picnic with us and barbecue with us, and the yellow jackets and the flies and the fleas and indigestion and everything else. You'll be able to experience all the suffering and misery and death and sickness. I mean, this is incredible. You know, so you can't do that unless you accept this, you know, from us. What a deal we have for you, God, today. What a deal. God, what a deal we have for you today. So we need to look at this and keep laughing along with the, you know, the heavy stuff of saying, you know, wow, maybe officialdom and corporate culture hasn't really told us what's going on. They haven't told us about the ETs, the covert space program, the incorporation of planet Earth, the pressure to comply, collapse into compliance, the possible, you know, booby trapping of the economy, global economy, the attempt to collapse all that, you know, the attempts to bring about crises, all the executive orders and laws in place to bring about martial law, you know, on and on and on. Whoops, they haven't told us about that, any of that stuff. Wonder why. They want a very smooth transition is what they want. They want this incorporation to leave them in, you know, in power and greed and leave all that in place. And be smooth, real smooth. Everyone just keep going like, oh, that's normal, yeah. Sure it is. There's some heavy, heavy symbology going on too, if you notice it. I just noticed something tonight. It's just like, wow. This is too heavy to to ignore. I don't want to get into it too much because it has to do with powerful persons in the world, and they don't, maybe don't take so kindly to having their veil and being unveiled. This is the apocalypse now, it's the unveiling of all what's going on, right? So, the medicine is this levity. Is this beaming, you know, levity and seeing how silly it all is and not taking any of it seriously, actually, because we are God. All is God. All is blessed with perfect freedom. There's no product at all to ever obtain or to market in any way. We're all perfectly safe, perfectly loved. All is. So there's no situations or circumstances that no one's bound by anything, either by the necessity to change or the necessity to not change. There's no bondage anywhere, actually, for anyone. And the means that we try to convince God there is are quite hilarious. And we have to learn to laugh at them, absolutely. And we make all sorts of appeals to God, all silly. Silly. So see if some of these come up for you. I know today there are a number of them. I can't quite remember, you know, which they were, but they were, oh, that's a real good one. Wow. Yeah. That one's in use a lot. And sometimes you just be walking along in like a market or whatever, and you'll see someone suddenly pop in your head. Oh, gosh. That's the marketing that they're using. Oh, I see. All right. How about this one? I'm just a silly, giggly, you know, person. I'm so superficial, God. I mean, how could I fool you? It's ridiculous. I don't have the savvy to fool you. And this must be a good product, Death, because I'm just, you know, I'm just a dumb blonde, so to speak, you know, the dumb blonde one tactic. You know, I'm just this silly one. Life is wonderful, God. Dumb blonde. I couldn't possibly be selling you anything that was bad for you or anything like that. I don't have the deviousness of that at all, you know. So you can trust me, this product will be fine for you. Okay, sure. Because I'm all good, it's all good, you know. Simple, very simple minded here. I love dogs so much, and I would never do anything bad because I'm a dog lover, I'm an animal lover. God, how can an animal lover ever offer you anything that wouldn't be perfect for you? Actually, couldn't possibly be bad for you, could it? See, I'm such a good person. I even love animals. Yeah, I love trees, I love everything here, God. I could never do anything that isn't full of love, and so to hear this gift of Death for you must also be full of love, there's no question about it. Or, God, I didn't even know you existed up until now. I mean, as an atheist, so how could I possibly have been marketing anything to you all these years? No, it's not possible. It's just, I just have this wonderful product, and now that I realize you are real, you know. So, yeah, sure, here, let me give it to you. But, you know, I didn't even know you existed, so I couldn't possibly have been trying to market it to you. Claim ignorance. God, I'm so ignorant and stupid, it can't be bad for you. Or God, we're so smart and clever, we couldn't possibly, we've ironed out all the bugs. Don't worry, you can't be hacked. God, don't worry, you know, nothing will go wrong. We've got worked out all the problems for you. Look at this, God, it's even color coordinated with you. Isn't that neat? Let's put a little bow on it. Isn't that sweet? How can you resist it? It's meant for you. I just noticed, you know, it's like color coordinated. You know, it's obviously meant for you. That's how it goes. There's a high. I'm sensing a high compatibility factor. I'm getting something psychic. Wait a minute. Wow. I actually am seeing, I'm remote viewing the future, and I actually seeing God, that I'm seeing you accept it in the future. I'm seeing actually it happen. And wow, it's just amazing how wonderful it is when this happens. Yeah. I'll do a reading on you, God, a tarot reading. This card said, wow, my God, look at that card. It came up. It's the card of acceptance. This is your destiny, God. I've just foretold your destiny. I'll tell you what, God, let's roll some dice for it. Winner gets it, loser has to part with it. Let's play a little dice game over this. Oh, you won. Wow. Or I lost. Doggone it. Well, I'm an honorable person, so I'll have to give it to you anyway. Didn't really want to. Or, God, it's my honor. I promised my wife, I promised my spouse I would give this to you. And I gave my word of honor. They would do this, so, you know, you don't want me to go back on my word, do you? God, I'm so stupid, I just don't understand. I can't understand you're not accepting it. It's just not something I can understand. Or, God, if you don't accept this, I'm going to go completely insane because I simply don't understand it. How could you not take it? I'm going to go have a complete breakdown. God, if you accept this, I promise you I will break all my bad habits forever. I will be a changed person. I will have no question about it. There's almost no end to this, really. And we use them all. We use them all. And here comes some new alien races. They got all there. Clever strategies too, right? We more the merrier. Diversity is called. Inclusion, diversity. Bring in some more marketing techniques here. Let's, you know, spin the wheel. Guess what, God? You won. You're lucky. You're lucky, God, actually. It's unbelievable how lucky you are. I mean, the odds, you know, God, the odds of you winning this prize of death are astronomical, actually. Totally astronomical. In fact, I can't even calculate the odds. I mean, it just proves that you're God because you're so lucky that we can't even fathom how lucky you are that you actually won this. It's a prize. First prize. You're God. You won first prize. Proves you're God, doesn't it? That you get first prize. It's the sign that we've all been waiting for. The sign of acceptance. The sign that we did good. The sign of inclusion, that finally we can return home now that you've acknowledged us as your son, you know, a spirit, by accepting this gift from us. So, it's great. We can wrap it all up now, God. It's a wrap, you know. That's it. No need any more. Thank you for accepting it. It's a complete mystery and a miracle how it is that this is actually for you and is acceptable to you. But, you know, it must be your grace that's allowing it, right? It's a sign of your grace. The acceptance of this is the ultimate sign of your grace that you are indeed God. So, of course, we try to make it seem like if God doesn't accept it, that means God's proving that God is not God. You see, this is one of the ways we try to work the situation. We're all these peddlers, these petty peddlers of these strategies. You wonder, what are these peddlers? You know, these people, you have these cards full of all these knickknacks and how they're so good at haggling and selling. They're practicing selling to God. You know, they try, let me practice on this one. And they have all these clever little things, you know, to get you to buy. And they say, wow, I can use this on God now, finally. Yeah. I say, God, if you don't take this off our hands, we're gonna die, actually. So you gotta save, if you wanna save us, you gotta take it. Otherwise we'll succumb to this. It's a terrible plague upon us, God. So save us, God, please, we're going under. catastrophe is upon us. God save us. We'll all be annihilated if you don't take this off of us. You see how we even generate catastrophe for us as a marketing technique, part of the campaign, to try and make God feel so nervous. Oh my God, y'all, you're going to be annihilated if I don't take this from you. I've got to do it, you know? And so we have these bodies be annihilated, bodies die, as if that's the death of our spirit. We're trying to convince God that we're these bodies so that we're vulnerable to death. And if God doesn't take it from us, we're going to die. Yeah. That spirit's going to die. Now, see, God knows that we are spirit. And as our exact, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. So God sees us that we're spirit, we're completely invulnerable, we can't die. And all this stuff is just a ridiculous joke, that we're prank we're playing on God, trying to get God to buy this. Like a child trying to convince the parent, you know. Now this leaf really is a boat. Parents say, yeah, you see this leaf and how I made it into a boat. Is it really a boat and you can get in the boat? I want to sell this to you. You know, kids can be like that. I got something really valuable here I want to sell you. Or give to you. God, this will complete you, actually. This is the completion, the final completion. And then all of eternity and reality will finally be one and complete. God, the acceptance of this is our setting down of it. You know, don't you understand that? This is how we set it down. So we give it to you. We give it to you. You see, we give all our sins to you. Here you go. Here's our sins. Take our death. Here's our death. And that is our setting down. That is our salvation, God. Only you. We know you'll accept it for us. We know you want us to be saved. So, and of course, God cannot accept. There's nothing to accept. The reality hasn't changed. Everything's perfect. There's nothing to accept. There's no product to accept, no situation or circumstance to accept. So that doesn't work either. And then we say, you know, the problem is we just all need to agree. You see, God's waiting for us to all agree. God will say, oh, God, I understand why you can't accept you, because there's some of us here that actually disagree with this and don't want you to accept it. See, that's the problem, God. As soon as we get everybody here to agree to give up this prize of death to you, then we know that you'll then feel. See, you don't want to take it because you think there's some of us here who don't want to give it. You don't want to get them angry at you. You don't want to hurt their feelings by accepting it. So you need to wait until we all agree as one. Yes, God, we all agree that we want to give this to you. And so I see you're just merciful. You're just waiting. You don't want to upset anyone at all. The ones who don't want to give it, you say, well, I'll wait. You say, you're just waiting for them to come around. Okay, so we'll help you out, do your work here in this world, and convince everybody we got to get on the same page here. And once we all get on the same page, then we know that there'll be no more hindrance to you, God, and you'll realize it is perfectly right and just and merciful to accept this gift from us. And then it is done. It will be done. As it is written, so shall it be done. And it shall be done in that day when everybody is in compliance with agreeing that they're willing to give up this precious, precious gift to you, God. You know, God, we're just selfish. We don't want to give up this gift because we're all selfish greed. But we've finally seen the light, and we're going to give it up. We're going to give it to you now. Isn't that wonderful? And this is our personality, isn't it? You start digging in, you realize we have this our personality is just a collection of marketing strategies, actually. It's a collection of marketing strategies. God, I feel so, you know, sick of this, and so the only cure is for you to take this. If you don't, I'm going to die, actually. Yeah, and so the bodies die. But we don't need to. We don't need to use our body as part of a marketing strategy, actually. We can drop the marketing strategy. The body doesn't need to die, doesn't need to live, doesn't need anything. It doesn't have any needs, actually. It's all just a marketing strategy. Time is getting a little, it's not too late, but it's a chilly January evening here. We say, God, you know, I want to tell you something. I want to confess you otherwise. I have finally seen the light. So, thank you for taking this. Please accept my conversion, the fruits of my conversion. This is the completion, God, of the long path you sent me upon, the path of extirpating my sin, the sin of being unwilling to grace to give this to you, actually. As I've been on this spiritual path for so long, God, and finally, this is the final step now, is where you take this from me, and the path is then complete. You see, it puts the God in the position of having to deny your long path. And so we put long path as part of our marketing strategy. Keep this in mind, that we put ourselves on this long seeming path so we can use this as leverage of guilt towards God, saying, God, what a grace this path has been. It's been a long, difficult, brutal path, God, but I know it's worth it because it brings me to your doorstep, where the doorstep of acceptance, where finally I'm able to offer up this precious gift to you. And this is the culmination, the result of an extremely long path I've been on, being loyal and faithful to your word the whole time and doing the very best I could. And so that this is finally the end of this path I've been on. I'm so tired of it, so weary, got ready to collapse. So isn't it great that I'm at the doorstep here of your acceptance? And we, of course, we put the pressure on God. And so, you know, say, well, what could God say? No? I mean, it puts God in a very bad light. We've spent so much time and effort on this. You know, we've suffered so badly for this. And what can God do? You know, so we think that works. This longevity of a long time, effort on the path, long time. God, many billions and trillions have died for this effort. And if you don't accept it now, all their efforts will be in vain. All in vain. They will have died in vain. They will have marketed in vain. You know? And we can't take this. It's too upsetting for us, actually. Have some mercy upon us, God. Be a merciful God. Be a merciful God. Oh, God is merciful by telling us there's nothing to buy. There's nothing. There isn't any gift there. That's being merciful. God, I got this all. The whole thing I figured out. It's all on a timer. And click, 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 click. It's all, oh my gosh, it's coming to the point where you're going to accept automatically. It's all timed. I understand that you set the whole thing up as some timed mechanism of automatic acceptance. All I need to do is just be here at that moment, and it's done deal. In fact, your entire creation is like that. It's all a cosmic clock designed to bring about your acceptance of this. And of course, if that doesn't happen, that means the whole creation is a complete sham, right, God? See, complete sham. You've been deceiving everybody, you know. Try to put the guilt on God, which only causes ourselves guilt. You know, we're just putting guilt on ourselves. We're marketing guilt. Every kind of deceit and treachery, trickeration and everything. We're marketing that techniques, trying to get God to say, yes. Don't underestimate our marketing zeal, you know, and what's coming. We're going to lay some pretty heavy marketing tactics on God coming up real soon. Such as, God, we finally saw the light, and we're all going to get together and hold hands, sing Kumbaya, and agree that this is the key to your acceptance. We're going to. So it's coming now, and of course, those who don't agree, we finally decided, God, I'll tell you what, God, we finally realized that you've just been waiting for us this whole time for us to get tough, do some tough love. And for those who don't agree to give you this gift, God, we realize that you want us to actually dispatch them, get rid of them. And you've just been waiting for us to finally get tough and show how much we really want to give this to you. So we finally realized that, and we're finally getting tough now. So this is bringing our salvation to culmination. We realize that. So it's a re-education and work camps for all those who are dragging their heels. And we know that this is what you really want. Because before we were tolerating them and you couldn't stand it. We understand that because you want it so badly. And there's these holdouts of who are disagreeing and you want it to be unanimous. It has to be unanimous. So we realize that we just got to get rid of these folks. And that'll bring us to unanimity. And you know, we will unanimously give this to you, and then we know you will accept it. So, time to get tough. We thank you, God, for finally showing us the light that we need to bring the hammer down on these folks. You know, this is part of the marketing strategy. This is a strategy they can try, right? Has been tried before in many places, and likely can be tried here in many ways, too. Time to get tough, tough love. Time for action. Time for steamrolling, you know, to steamroll over the opposition. I said, God, we know you just wanted a smooth attitude here, so we got rid of all the bad attitude. We knew that bad attitude was intolerant to you. It made you sick. You know, so sick that you didn't even want this great gift of death we have for you. But now all the attitudes are all pro, you know, pro, yeah, let's give this to God. Now, we don't realize that now you're in a better mood and you're in the mood of acceptance. So we're so happy to be here at such an auspicious time. Such an auspicious moment, justifying all the heavy work, heavy lifting that we did, all the head-busting heavy lifting that we did, totally justifies it. Because now we've reached the moment of final acceptance here. Everybody's here now. The whole cosmos, God, is here now. This one moment of final acceptance, freeing us all. Isn't this amazing? Hallelujah. This is the moment. Yeah. We're all waiting here. Yeah, waiting for it. Not yet. To what happened? We overlooked someone. There must be a traitor among us. There must be a traitor. Oh, I know who the traitor is. Boom, let's bust their head, the traitor among us. Okay, God, now we got rid of the traitor. Now we know you're in a good mood. Now you realize how much we really care and how we are unified. See, what you're waiting for is us to be unified in our desire to give you death. And now we're totally unified. So, here it is. You didn't accept it. There must be another traitor in our midst. Wait a minute, guys. The whole conspiracy here. Traitors. Let me get rid of them. Get right back to you. You know, get right back to you. You just got to do some more clean-up work. Oh, I see. They're not in alignment. They haven't quite unified yet, God. But we're gonna get that done in a big hurry. We'll be right back. Get right back to you. Hey, God, the reason why I haven't given it to you yet is I lost your number. Pat Manil will call you. I kind of misplaced it. And anyway, I wanted to. I just couldn't get a hold of you. So now, finally, it's here it is. God, we realize that you evolved just like we evolved. And we realize we evolved to the point where this is now possible. Isn't that great? Hallelujah. God be praised. Hallelujah. Yes, it has finally come. It is finally here. The moment is here. The moment has arrived. Our liberation, our salvation has finally come. So, all glory to God, all glory to God, all glory to God. And I know it's happened. I know it's happened. I feel it's happened. Thank you, God, it's happened. Yes, it's happened. Praise to God, it's happened. I know it's happened. Can you feel it? Can you feel it? Yeah, you feel it too? You feel it too, don't you? You know what? There's some here that don't quite feel it yet. And this is a problem for you. Because God has done it. And he has done it already. All you need to do is accept that he's done it. That he's accepted death. He's finally done it. All you need to do is accept this fact and you will be saved. You see, the problem. That's the problem. And God's glory will not be complete until you have actually accepted the fact that he did accept death from us, finally. And as soon as you accept this fact, you will be freed of your burden too. Except you'll still have the burden of convincing everybody else that it's happened too. So it has to be complete unification of all this. And those who are actually resistant, so resistant, well, you know what? They're inherently evil, and they need to be cast into a lake of fire and annihilated forever. So you won't even have to worry about the burden of convincing them and changing their mind. They'll be destroyed. And then God will have this beautiful kingdom of unification. We'll all know that God has accepted the gift of death from us, and we'll be happy forevermore. Amen and amen and amen to that. You see? Just don't forget to laugh at it, right? Because this is how it is. This is just another marketing tactic, actually. Again, in reality, we are absolutely perfectly free. All is perfect freedom, always. No force to change our experiencing, no force to not change our experiencing. And that's it. That's it. This is God. This is God. And there's no product to sell God at all. We're already this way. This is how reality is right now. There's no need to wait for someone to accept the belief that God has accepted death, accepted a product from us, you know. There's none of that whatsoever. That's a silly jest. And so you can bring up all these different marketing tactics. It's all lasted a long time. Some come and go, you know. It's all the same. Don't draw any. Say one's more effective than another, or one's less effective than another. They're all zero effective. They're all equally zero effective. Okay, this is our message here. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally ineffective. This is what we've been saying for years. All attempts to accomplish the impossible, equally ineffective. Equally futile, equally nothing, equally zero. Okay, so we got the ball rolling, and it's this beaming, you know, just this is what's needed in the world, this great spiritual humor, great good humor. When I had this meeting with Jesus, and while he was asleep, his attitude was just smiling. He was great humor, and you could see the twinkle in his eye. As far as his attitude was, it was like, this is all just a ridiculous funny joke. And he laughed at it. He said, yeah, I remember that one too. I said, oh yeah, they played, tried to get that one, and I see that. It was quite funny. In retrospect, is how, yeah, I know all these. I know all these tricks and what they, you know, how to sell. And they say, oh yeah, sure. And he's mirthful about it, you know, and had a twinkle and smile. And that's how we need to be. This is how we can be, actually. Let's put this out. This is how we can be. Absolutely, we can start practicing it. Hey God, wait a minute, hold this for me just a minute. I want to take a picture just for my memento, Joe. Can you just hold this for me for just a second here? Let me take this picture. Go on, hold it, you can hold it. Hold it up. I want to take this for my family, for my scrapbook, for my memoirs. Hey God, I baked this specially for you. Can you try it out? Just tell me how it tastes. I just want to know if you like it. On and on and on and on and on and on and on. We all think we're so clever. You're like, maybe this will work. I think this might work. I hope this will work. I hope it'll work. And doesn't work. That's the secret. Doesn't work. God, I know. You know, God, I don't know who this is for. Someone gave it to me. Or actually, God, I found this. Someone lost it somewhere. I don't know. I know that you will honor and won't keep it for yourself or anything. Can you just take it for me? I give it to you for now, and you hold on to it for me until we find who it belongs to. You know, could you do that for me? Dharma, etc., 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 etc. So go over them, get used to them, lighten up, lighten up, lighten up, lighten up, lighten up as oil keeps crashing down. And the tempest, you know, is coming upon us. You know, we have this light, smooth light. Like, yeah. Funny, that one's funny too. That one's funny too. And laugh our way into the real world. Where our continuity fear could finally, you know, come evaporate entirely. Where the marketing of life and the marketing of death are seen as one silly, silly jest of trying to change reality. And nothing more than that, that this is a final little laugh at how silly it was, and that's it. And that's it, done. Okay. And here's another one. God, can you just hold this for me one time, is all I'm asking you. Just one time. And then I'll take it back. But I just want you to hold just once for me. That's not asking too much. Just for 1 second. For one instant, actually, God, I tell you. Other people, they want it for an hour, days, years, eternity. I just want you to hold it for one instant, is all. See, I'm reasonable. I'm way better than those other ones that are telling you they want you to hold it forever, for 1,000 years or something. I actually just want you to hold it for one instant. See, this is I'm way more advanced. You see, I'm way closer to you in understanding, right? I understand that's ridiculous what they're asking, but this one instant is just a tiny instant, actually. A tiny little instant is all that I'm requesting from you. So I'm really a good person, right, God? I'm a really good person for asking. Of course, if there's no product there, how can you hold it at all? You get a million, asking for a million years in one instant, that's exactly the same silliness. Exactly the same silliness. And with that, we come to a close of this video. Very great. That's it.